Hello, and welcome to our first ever Ready, Set, Go Ladies event. We're so excited you are here. Here at Grace, we typically host a conference or a retreat each year, but as we've been listening to you ladies share, we've realized that getting together once a year just isn't enough. So that's where the Ready, Set, Go Ladies events were born. We're excited to be able to offer 3 to 4 events similar to this one each year, but with a twist. Tonight, we'll be looking at self-care. Self-care from the world feeds us what we want, not what we need. True self-care is not an excuse to treat ourselves to whatever we want. This is a good thing because when we chase after what we want, we often miss out on what we need. I pray that after tonight, you'll be able to create new practices of rest and self-care that actually nourish you rather than leave you more tired and exhausted. I know after a long, hard day, we all want to unplug. Unplugging from the noise is a good thing, but the world just leaves it at that. Godly self-care means unplugging, but plugging back into something bigger. We see this with Jesus several times. He leaves the crowds to find solitude. He's unplugging from activity, but plugging back into the hope he has in his Father. Oftentimes we can unplug, but then just scroll mindlessly on social media or flip through the channels on our favorite stations. We escape our problems for a time until we have to return back to them again. We can't give everything we have in worship to the Lord and to those around us if we haven't cared for our minds, bodies, and hearts that God has given us. Tonight, we are going to dive into self-care in regards to our physical, spiritual, and mental self-care. We're going to uncover how to fill up each one of those cups that are often left empty for way too long. I'd love to introduce our first speaker speaking on physical self-care, Lauren Bowman. She is a wife and a mama to 2 beautiful children. If you haven't met her yet, you need to. She is amazing and has been a huge blessing to many of us. She has a love for exercise and the Lord. You're about to experience what happens when you put the 2 of those together with a lot of added flair. Take it away, Miss Lauren.
First, because I know some of you are already cringing in your seats, just the thought of talking about exercise and healthy eating and those things, you're already shutting your ears because of past hurts, wounds related to food, food addiction, body weight, body shaming, or physical insecurities. Those are deep-rooted and something that I don't overlook. 2, every woman is also thinking, I don't have time to exercise. I don't have time to make Pinterest-worthy healthy meals. I am stressed. I am tired. I agree, but we'll talk about it. And 3, there is so much information about health and wellness, and so much of it controversial. How do you decipher what to listen to and what not to? So after some prayer and probably 6 rewrites, God told me, I'm telling you exactly what you want to talk about or you should talk about. It's those 3 things. So let's get started. The first barrier, past hurts. We live in a society that glorifies perfection. Having the perfect haircut, perfect color, makeup, wardrobe, body shape, and all around outward beauty. I actually know, or I have felt these feelings of inadequacy more than I'd like to admit. I actually remember feeling these first feelings of inadequacy back in the 4th or 5th grade. I remember crying in my bed, feeling like I just wasn't enough. I wasn't popular or athletic. I was always picked last in gym. Who knew I would make a fitness career? I remember the night I laid in bed and I went down to my mom crying, and she encouraged me, she supported me, and she did exactly what a good mother would do. But I wish I could say that her pep talk pumped me up and got me ready to go for the rest of my life, but I still battle these feelings of inadequacy. We so easily put ourselves down, compare ourselves to unrealistic expectations, but that is not who we are. For God says, "For you are a people holy to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you out of all the people of the face of the earth to be his people, his treasured possession. Deuteronomy 7:6. We are God's treasured possession. How beautiful. No matter the negative things the world has told you about your physical body, that is not your identity in Christ. You are a child of God, and you are perfect in his sight. Two other verses that prove this. I will praise you. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. Indeed, the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. Let these truths sink in. God loves you, God created you, and he thinks you're perfect. We should be proud of his craftsmanship. The second barrier, I have too much to do. I don't have enough time. And time always tends to be finite, doesn't it? We never have enough time to do the things we want to do or the things we should do. And I know this really hit me hard when I became a mom of two. Everyone needing you at once, the house in a disarray all the time, and being sleep deprived on top of it. Finding time to shower, let alone exercise and cooking, was a struggle. And I even wanted to exercise because I enjoy it. So as a mom, as a boss, as a daughter, we are called to be selfless. In Philippians, it says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but into the interests of others. As women, I think we do that pretty naturally. But God also calls us to take care of our physical bodies. In 1 Corinthians, do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. If we keep pouring out of our physical cup, we will never be able to serve, love, or be patient with those we care for simply because our bodies are run down. Taking care of others means taking care of you too. Notice I did not say taking care of yourself first, which can be misconstrued in our society today. If your physical body always ends up on the bottom of your priority list, you will run your body down and no longer be able to serve. Lastly, how do I put this all into practice? The American College of Lifestyle Medicine has 6 areas of health and wellness: physical activity, healthy eating, stress management, substance control, sleep, and formation of positive relationships. Each of these areas is very important, but for today's discussion, I'm going to focus on sleep and rest, physical activity, and healthy eating. You'll probably find some of those other topics in Amber and Bonnie's conversations. So first, sleep and rest. You all are thinking, yeah, right, there's no way I can get more sleep. But we all know it's important. It's imperative for body repair, memory, and healing. Somewhere along the line, we fool ourselves thinking, if I just do a little more, if I stay up a little bit later, if I get up a little bit earlier, everything will be better. And yes, there is benefit to being proactive and doing those things, but let us remember, even God rested on the 7th day. In Genesis, by the 7th day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the 7th day, he rested from all his work. Then God blessed the 7th day and made it holy, because on it he rested from all the work he was creating he had done. Let us also remember that Jesus rested. Then, because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest. So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. There is no greater example of how to live other than our Heavenly Father. He created the heavens and the earth, and he rested. So adults should shoot for 7.5 to 9 hours of sleep. And I know after a long day, it's really tempting to just veg out, scroll social media. Amber already talked about this. Frantically clean up from a busy day or even prep for the next day. But I challenge you to really start identifying time suckers in your day like that and how you might increase your time sleeping. If increasing your amount of sleep just isn't possible, then we of course want to focus on the quality of sleep. Now, we know with babies, you kind of create a bedtime routine to help them go to sleep. We'll do the same for you. Read your Bible, take a warm shower, try not to exercise or eat 3 hours before you plan to go to bed. Go to the bed at the same time every night. These simple things can make the quality of sleep and the amount of time you're in REM sleep, that's your deep repair, or a sleep that repairs the body and the mind, it will help that all go better. Now, cat naps and power naps can be beneficial too, but they obviously do not make up for a good night's rest. Next, physical activity, my favorite. I'd love to talk to you all about the benefits, the types, the studied ways to meet specific goals, but I'll just kind of jump to the point. We need to move more. For general health and filling your physical cup, it doesn't matter how or when, just moving regularly and consistently. Physical activity is linked to decreased risk of kidney disease, heart disease, diabetes, stroke, certain kinds of cancers, and stress. Increases energy and improves mood. And if there is not a scientific proof that will convince you to move even just a little bit more, I think that is the sentence. Even 10 minutes of cardiovascular training or just gentle movement is associated with long-term results. Now, what this means is even small things make a really big difference. So you've heard it before, park far away at the parking lot, walk around the field during soccer practice, use a bathroom on a different floor at work. Wherever you can squeeze in those small opportunities of physical activity will make a difference. During a commercial, stand up, march in place, when you're waiting for your coffee to brew, walk up and down the stairs, whatever it is, those little things can make a big difference. Now, healthy eating. I saved the hardest for last. I think this is the area that most women feel judged, and it really is one of the hardest areas to make a change to. So, before I get started, let us remember, do not destroy the work of God for the sake of food. All food is clean, but it is wrong for a person to eat anything that causes someone else to stumble. We're all on a different wellness path. I'm not here to judge or condemn your eating habits, or even to promote a specific diet. I'm here to provide just some little tips to help you eat and fuel your body better. So, we'll start with the big picture. Sorry, it's a little blurry, but that's the big picture. This is what a healthy eating plate should look like. So you'll notice that half of the plate is fruits and veggies, all fresh. Cooked, raw, soups, those types of things, lots of color. A quarter of the plate are your lean proteins, your poultry, meat, fish, eggs, legumes and nuts. You'll see a little bit smaller than a quarter of the plate, your pasta, rice, potatoes, and breads, and what you would generally consider as carbs. There's a lot of controversy about carbs, no carbs. Well, I'm going to tell you, your body thrives on a variety of foods, so it's important to include everything. And then that little sliver there, that is for your fats as well. So, if your plate looks like this, kind of all those little details will be put into place. But if I could give you two more simple tips, that would be focusing on whole foods. So trying to go for snacks that don't have a food label as opposed to having a food label. So everything that's on the half of that plate, your fruits, your veggies, things that naturally have no label. That increases the food or the vitamins and the minerals that you will intake and that your body needs to function. 2, drink lots of water. Appropriate levels of hydration are positively affected with satiety, fatigue, and cognition. You want to shoot for half your body weight in fluid ounces daily. This is a big challenge for me, I will admit. I just don't get thirsty. So I have actually started setting an alarm on my phone every 2 hours to go drink water. That is so silly, but I want to drink more water, and those little reminders are going to help me reach that goal. Okay, so we talked about a couple eating habits, but now let's talk about consistency. Regardless of your goals, regardless of the healthy eatings that you make on or make each day, if you are not consistent, you will not see the benefits. I really like to discuss or promote the 80-20 rule. And what this states is that 80% of the time you are consistent with healthy eating, exercise, and trying to do things that fuel your body appropriately. But you give yourself 20% of grace. You're a little less strict during that time. The key here is not to completely fall off that wagon if you enjoyed one of those beautiful cookies or a piece of that cake tonight. You do it guilt-free. Another analogy I once heard along the lines was comparing your nutrition habits to a car. Now, when you get a flat tire, do you slash all the other tires by eating the entire cake? No. You fix your flat tire and you get on your way. You just move along and, oh, I maybe fell off my nutrition plan for today or for the week, but tomorrow I'm just going to jump right back on and do what I had already planned and what my goal is. And SMART goals. This is where we would really like to help you, ladies. Now, I already feel like I've probably spilled out so much information to you, and you're going to leave here feeling like we shot a fire hose to your face. So it's not our intention for you to leave, or it is our intention here for you to leave recognizing the importance of those really small goals in all three areas of self-care. Each speaker today will give you a challenge to complete for the next 14 days in their specified topic. The papers in front of you are optional tools to help you if you choose to take on this 14-day challenge. You'll see one paper that says to keep. It has three boxes on it, denoting physical, emotional, and spiritual. You'll want to write in the challenge that each speaker gives you in that box. You can then take this home, place it by your toothbrush, or put it by the fridge, just to help you stay focused on that challenge. Like I said, I'm setting an alarm to drink water. Wherever you can remind yourself to complete this goal, the better. For a little extra motivation, you can fill out the second paper with your name and phone number to join a group text. The speakers will be gently reminding you and encouraging you to meet your goal along the way. Please just leave that paper on the table when you leave and we'll pick them up. My challenge, my physical challenge, is to do something physically active for 15 minutes a day. I don't care what it is. Maybe it's walking your dog. Maybe it's playing with the grandkids in the backyard. Maybe it's gardening. Whatever you choose to do to be physically active is yours. So, with that being said, I couldn't get on stage without doing a little bit of an exercise class with you all. So, we're gonna do a very gentle exercise, a little bit of stretching. I want to give you a couple of modifications when you get up. So can I have everybody stand up with me? I see smiling faces already. It will be easy, I promise. You'll need just a little bit of space. I hope you are feeling energized after sitting for a little while. As you guys are settling down, I want to introduce the next speaker, Amber Hager. Amber was one of my first friends here at Grace Community Church. As my husband and I walked in awkwardly, we made eye contact, and she immediately came up with me with a warm smile. Her love for Jesus shines in every word and every action. It only makes sense that she would be talking about the spiritual aspect of self-care today. She has encouraged me to read my Bible more, seek God's voice in all of life's decisions, and love as Jesus did. A little forewarning, though, if you make eye contact with her at church, you will be invited to the next women's event and possibly be signed up to serve somewhere in the church.
Thank you. Yes. Can you make me cry? If we can get that to work. Hey, there we are. Ah, that was awesome. I got so excited that, like, I was falling all over the place over there, and I feel a little, like, overdressed after coming up after Lauren here in her outfit, but that was awesome. Thank you, Lauren. So, like the other areas of spiritual, of self-care, spiritual growth and spiritual maturity doesn't come naturally. It takes intentionality. It's a process that takes commitment and discipline, just like we just talked about. Nutritionists remind us that we have to have the minimum daily requirements of vitamins and minerals and foods and things that Lauren just talked about. And in the same way, David gives God's minimum requirements to be spiritually healthy. And we see that in Psalm 105, 1 through 4. The first requirement is praise. It says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Sing to him, sing praises to him." Praise means giving thanks for all God is doing, all he's given to us, all he's shared. And we get to rejoice in the presence of the Lord because of who he is and because we are his children. Prayer is also essential. It says, call on his name. We call on the Lord when we need strength, grace, help in a time of need. He is there, and he always hears us. Witnessing is another element that's talked about. It says, make his works known among the people. Tell of his great works and honor his holy name. If we only praise and pray, but we don't present the Lord to other people, our lives will really be meaningless. We need to tell others of that love that we have received from Jesus and the amazing things that he is doing in and through our lives. The final daily requirement for spiritual self-care is seeking his face. It says, look for the Lord in his strength. Look for his face all the time. I love that, all the time. In other words, live your life in the light of God's character. Live with a smile of God on your life and seek to please him, only him. Not your neighbor, not your friends, but the Lord. So we're going to jump into some of these and go a little bit deeper. We're not actually going to jump like Lauren did, so don't worry, I'll let you sit down. We're going to start by talking about reading our Bible. It's important to take time for God's Word. Christianity Today did a study, and it says that 80% of church-going Christians don't read their Bibles daily. That doesn't really surprise me very much because I used to be one of those people, and sometimes I still fall back into that habit. As I was thinking about and wondering why Christians don't read their Bibles regularly, let alone daily, I realized that the answers must be that they don't understand the power behind reading the Bible, that life-giving power on every single page. When I was at that stage where I didn't really read my Bible, I never understood why people liked it so much and why they were so excited about it and why they made it such a priority in their life. I just didn't get it. But when I read it, it was kind of like hard. It was hard to make the time, and it was kind of bland, and I was like, yeah, okay, I got other things to do. I didn't really get it. But there was something to the people who were telling me how much they loved their Bible and how much they loved their quiet time that was really unique and beautiful, and it really drew me into them. There was something that I really loved about them. And because of that, I knew that I wanted to love reading my Bible. I wanted to have that desire that I was seeing in those other ladies. And so I decided that I would start praying. And I would pray about it every single day until God answered that prayer and until I was able to have that desire to love my Bible. And so I did that. And of course, while I was doing that, I was still reading my Bible. I was still getting my check mark for the day. But it wasn't that deep emotion, you know, that deep reading. But I kept being consistent and persistent with it and kept praying about it. And it was funny because one day I was reading my Bible and it came alive, like amazing. Like it had to have just been God answering that prayer because in that moment it just came alive. And I found myself like keep reading and reading and reading. I didn't care about time. I didn't care about anything else that was happening on the planet at that time. I just was like, I want more of this. This is amazing. This is what people are talking about. And thank you, Lord. And it was amazing. I was so excited. I was out in my gym where I do my exercise and my quiet time in the morning. So I run in the house and I start telling the kids all about this. And they're like, whoa, Mom, like, what's going on? And then I called my husband at work. Yeah, you know, you shouldn't really do that, but I call him, right? And I'm like, oh, yeah, no, I need to talk to my husband. They're like, it's an emergency. Well, sort of. And so I'm like, did you know that the Bible says this and this and this? And he's like, yes. And I was like, okay, well, that's all. He's like, okay. So I just love bragging on God for that story because it just shows how he loves to delight and how he delights to bless his children and how he wants to give us those blessings when we desire them. We can't be healthy Christians without taking time to be with the Lord. It says in Matthew 4:4, it says, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Jesus died to make this relationship possible, and it's our source of strength. In the beginning, reading the Bible can feel a little overwhelming. You know, it's like really big, right? And it reminds me of that story when I was a kid where the sidewalk ends and it's like, how do you eat an elephant? And the answer is, one bite at a time. Exactly. And so if you've never taken time to read your Bible each day, you can start today. I put together a few things to help you get started. So I want to go through those a little quickly, but I just want to go through those. The first one is choose a Bible version that's easy to read and understand. Some of these here just use more everyday language. So if you're not into like the thous and the thou shall not and those things, this is more everyday language, and we can move up to those ones if you'd like. But the second one is you don't have to start at the beginning of the Bible. It's a lot of books in one, and so you can actually start in a lot of different places. I really recommend starting in the Gospel of John, which is in the New Testament, so it's a little bit more than halfway through the Bible. Read a little each day, kind of just like we were talking about with exercise. 5 to 10 minutes, just start somewhere. Something is better than nothing. And before you start, pray. Ask God to help you understand his word. He loves to reveal himself to people, his people that seek him. And the other thing is, write it down. As you read the Bible, ask yourself some questions. Here's a couple that I like to use. What does this teach me about God, about God's character, about who he is? And what does this teach me about how I should live? Or who I am in Christ. I love just starting there. Did you know that if you read the Bible for 15 minutes a day, you can actually make it through the entire Bible in a year? I think that's just amazing, and I love it. And one of the tools that I use is the YouVersion app. If you're not familiar with it, it's an awesome app. You can have audio Bible, so if you're on the go or if you're cooking and you just want to have some background noise and just be able to listen to the Bible, you can do it that way. You can set up Bible studies with friends. You can get daily encouragement. If you want to know more about it, catch up with me later. I love having that as a tool. I'm a very practical person, and I like to have tools to help me work through things that I struggle with, kind of like Lauren was saying, using that alarm. You know, we have these tools. We just have to put them into place. So that's one that I like. For you ladies who might be a little bit more mature in your walk, I wanted to also share a resource with you that I love using when I study the Bible. You should have a paper. Your facilitators at the table will have a paper for you, and it looks like this. And I can't remember who shared it with me, but I am happy to pass it on to you. I love using this. So basically, you take a scripture and you walk through the questions. For example, so you'd put the verse at the top, and then what is the verse that comes before it? Is the verse that comes after it? Is there any cultural context that you should that would be either interesting or good to help know as you're reading it? Characters, relationships, and then imagining yourself in the story. Like, what would that feel like? What would you see? What would you smell? And just, you know, feeling that part of it. You can kind of go through that. How does it challenge how I see God, myself, or the world? And my favorite one is the very last question. It says, how does this change what I will do today or tomorrow? How do I hear what God is saying and apply it to my life? It's always about application. If we can't apply it, then maybe, you know, it's like, if we can't apply it, we're going to still be in that same struggle. James 1:22 says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. It doesn't say read it, show up on Sunday, put your Bible up on a shelf. We're going to stay in it, and we're going to apply it to our lives and to our hearts and watch how our lives are changed. So we need to put what we're learning into practice every single day. We need to set an appointment with the Lord and keep it. You guys wouldn't set up an appointment with me and we're going to go have coffee or actually tea. We wouldn't do that and then you guys not show up, right? But how many times do we do that with the God of the universe? And so it's just important that we set that time. So find your best time. What is your best time? Is it early in the morning, in the afternoon, after you get off work? Is it when you put the kids to bed? It doesn't matter when the time is. Just find a time where you can set it aside and be consistent. That is important. It's just be consistent. Show up every single day. So my challenge, I want to offer each of us a challenge, is to read our Bible for 15 minutes for the next 14 days. Whether you already do or whether this is new to you, if you are interested in doing this, and I hope you all are, but don't worry, I'm not keeping note. If you would write yes under the spiritual part on the self-care 14-day challenge on your table, I'm going to put together a group text and we're going to do this thing together. It's 15 minutes that will change your life, your mood, your heart, everything. So I hope you want to jump into that with me. The next area that we're going to talk about is prayer. That is the next area of maturing our spiritual health. So when we pray, we're releasing our grasp of our desires, our fears, and we're entrusting everything to the Lord, where nothing is impossible. When I was new to Christianity, I was always nervous to pray out loud. I was that one who sat in the group in the Bible study and they started going around in the prayers and I have no idea what they said because I was in my mind formulating what I was supposed to say because that all sounded really good and I knew it was coming to me and I didn't know what to say. And then one of my sweet friends was like, Amber, praying is just having a conversation with God. I'm like, oh, I can do this. Can do that. Okay. There's no right or wrong way to pray. God knows our hearts and he just loves hearing from us. He can also handle the times when our conversations and our prayers aren't really the sweetest. So when I was a new believer, my first mission that God gave me was to end a long-term relationship that I was in. And I really didn't want to. I really, really didn't want to. And I didn't, and because I was new to this whole, following Jesus thing, it wasn't a quick, confident, yes, Lord, no. I remember one night telling God, fine, I'll do what you're asking, but I'm not happy about it. And that was really my heart and my attitude. I don't mean, go do that. But what I'm saying is that God can handle those emotions, too. You know, it's kind of like our kids. We want to have them get it out so then we can work with it. And God just wants to hear from us. It doesn't matter how you come to him, just come to him. Sometimes I still don't have the words to say, so you know me, I have a tool for that. And you'll also find a form for that, and it's the ACTS prayer method. It's kind of more like a guide, and I really love it. God tells us to pray without ceasing. It says pray continually. And Paul beckons us to boldly enter the throne room for more mercy and grace. It says, let us approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. And we are assured that God hears the prayers of his people. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything in his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we have asked of him. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and the ears are attentive to their prayer, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Let's dive into this ACTS prayer guide and begin really exercising the privilege we have of prayer. The first one is adoration, and this is the opportunity for us to praise God. You can do this by praising his attributes or his characteristics. For example, I praise you, Lord, because you are holy. Without fail, as I spend time worshiping God, my eyes become fixed on him, and my faith grows, and I become more aware of how big he is than compared to my situation. And praising him puts my heart in the right position before the Most High. Then we have confession. This is the part of prayer where we lay down our mistakes before him. And this part is vulnerable and open, but God already knows all things, and he loves us despite our shortcomings. As we lay down our sins in the light, we are free because God is faithful to purify us and cleanse us of all of our sins. Next, we have thanksgiving. It is God's will that we give thanks in all circumstances. In all circumstances, not just the happy ones with the happy smiley emoji. Gratitude helps shift our gaze from what's wrong to what's right. It's really impossible to experience negative emotions when you're practicing gratitude. Try it. It really doesn't work. I tried it with my kids this week. I was like, I'm going to see if that works. And I was like, let's see. Okay, guys, a little grumpy. Let's practice gratitude. And this works. This is good. Giving thanks to God, the giver of all good gifts, is one of the most important parts of prayer. And the last one we have is supplication. And this means we're humbly asking God for something. When we acknowledge who God is, casting our cares on him is a no-brainer. Remember, he can do more in one moment than we can do in our entire lifetime. God delights to hear from us. So feel free to take that and make copies. There's also a bookmark in there if you want to keep that with you wherever you have your prayer time. All right. The next part we're going to go to is learning to recognize the voice of God. Can we hear his voice? Would we recognize it if we heard it? These are questions that have been asked by countless people over the ages. Samuel heard the voice of God, but he didn't even recognize it until he was instructed by Eli. And Gideon had a physical revelation from God, and he still doubted what he had heard to the point of wanting a sign, not just once, but three times. So when we're listening for God's voice, how can we know that he's the one speaking? Well, first of all, we have something that Gideon and Samuel didn't have. We have a complete Bible, the inspired word of God, to read and study and meditate on. It says all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Secondly, we have the Holy Spirit. Jesus told his disciples that the gift of the Holy Spirit would come when he was no longer on earth. To hear God's voice, we must belong to God. Jesus said, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me." Those who hear God's voice belong to him. Those who have been saved by his grace through faith in the Lord Jesus, These are the sheep who hear and recognize his voice because they know him as their good shepherd. If we're to recognize God's voice, well, we have to belong to him. Good works can't save us. Only faith in Jesus can. The Bible says there's one way to heaven. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and it is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one may boast. It's not about us, it's all about him. If you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. If you've come to the end of yourself and you're ready to leave those past mistakes and failures in the past, if you'd like to know more about inviting Jesus into your heart, please talk with me or one of the other speakers from tonight. We would love to introduce you to Jesus. Although God may use many ways to communicate with us, most likely he's going to use the time when we're in his word, when we're reading our Bible, and when we're praying. As we mature in our walk with the Lord, we can learn to recognize his voice. And when he speaks to us, then we can more confidently say, yes, Lord. So when our thoughts reoccur, pray about them. Discern if they're coming from God. Keep in mind that God will never tell you something that contradicts what he says in the Bible. Also, God's voice carries a weight of authority with it. And it expresses a sense of peace and confidence and joy. If you think God may be speaking to you about something, ask him to confirm it while you're studying and meditating in the Bible, in different circumstances, or even having him put it through the Holy Spirit as an impression on your heart or your mind. Once we've heard from God and we know it's his voice, then we can easily move forward with a confident yes. Yes, sir, I am going. And we can do that. So I want to do a little activity. I am going to grab Miss Arena over here. Can you come over here, please? Sorry, that was already on. I'm going to let you hold this for a minute because I'm going to blindfold you. She trusts me, right?
Kind of.
Oh, I know some of these other ladies are like, I am so glad Amber didn't pick me because I don't know. Is that good? Is it going to stay on? More? Less? Too low? Oh, no cheating. Well, I know. I'm trying not to mess up your makeup, too. Is that good? Tighter? Not tight? Okay. We're good?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So I'm going to take that from you.
Okay.
All right. So let me see. Am I good? Is it on?
I can't see you.
You can't? Well, I know. That's okay. I'm standing right here by you.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So what I'm going to do is I am going to give you instructions. And all I want you to do is I want you to just follow what I'm asking you to do. Can we do that? Okay. So first, I just want you to take 2 steps forward. And don't worry, I won't like let you bang into anything or whatever. We'll get creative. All right, so I want you to turn towards the right. Take 2 steps forward. Turn to the left. Take 3 steps. Wherever, just the direction you're walking. I'm right here so you won't fall, don't worry. I got you covered. All right, so we're gonna turn around all the way to the back. Turn all the way around. Yeah, that's good. Awesome, 2 more steps. All right, 2 more steps forward.
Turn to the right. One step forward.
All right. Who are you listening to?
I don't know. I know. It was you, but you gave the microphone to someone whose voice sounded kind of like you.
Okay. All right. Well, we can take it off. You guys get the point. Sorry, I don't want to mess up your makeup. All right. Well, I'm sorry, I didn't realize. Okay, thank you. I did not realize that you sounded like me, Carissa. Did you guys know that?
What were you?
It was slightly different, right? That's all right. All right, So you guys get the idea. But we have to, we have to know the voice that we're listening to. It's vital that we know whose voice we're listening to and the path that we're following. Choosing the wrong voice can lead us off the narrow path that God has called us to. And God's path is the path to life and righteousness. All right, so finally, once our spiritual cup is full, we've given praise, we've called on his name, we've read our Bible, we've prayed, we need to share the love we have found in Christ to the world. We should always be ready to testify to the amazing things that God is doing in and through us. We have found a great treasure, or I should say, maybe a great treasure has found us. But our joy and excitement should spread like wildfire. So stay connected to Christ through reading your Bible, through praying, learning to recognize the voice of God, and sharing the love that you found in Jesus with every person that God sends your way. I know I'm forever grateful to my friend Lorraine, my sister in Christ, who said yes to that challenge 20 years ago when she came and shared the gospel with me. It changed my life and my eternity, and I am forever grateful. And let us go and be those women to the other women and people in our lives. So praise God. Now, before I leave the stage, I want to bring up the amazing Bonnie Burcham. Bonnie can start making her way. Now, this lady, she makes me laugh. If I am having a hard day, I connect with Bonnie. If I know, like, I need that natural facelift and get those muscles going, this is who I call. She will always make me laugh. You can come all the way. Come on. Something else that you might find out in just a few minutes is that she loves words. Lots of words.
I do.
Words. And something I can say about her, because I do it too, is that Bonnie is a planner. And so if you want to go out and hang out with her for the day, don't worry about a thing, because she'll have it all planned out, and she will email you the perfectly organized spreadsheet.
I'm not emailing you the spreadsheet. That's my spreadsheet.
Oh, I don't get to know it ahead of time?
No.
But I'm a planner.
No.
We'll talk later. Okay, well, maybe you, well, okay, but I still love that about her anyways. So, So Bonnie is going to talk about mental, yeah, you got me off track. I was actually thinking about what else I could say now. I have you up here. But she's going to be sharing with us the mental and emotional side of self-care.
Love you.
Oh, so before I get started with the meat and potatoes of what I'm talking about, I'm sorry. Before I get started with the sticks and stones. No, it's going to be nice. I just love coming to these conferences, and I swear, somebody says it every single time, but there's a very small amount of coordination that we do with our talking. Legit, it was like, this is the subject, and here's kind of my general idea. But as I'm listening to Lauren and I'm listening to Amber, I'm like, I use that verse. God told me to say that. And so I love that he puts these things together. So what you're going to hear is not from me. I pray that it is not from me, it is from God. And everything that I'm going to talk to you about tonight is something that I have struggled with, am not perfect at, and during this preparation have had to be like, Bonnie, what are you talking about again? Oh yeah, you need to do that before you tell a room full of women to do that. So we are all on the same page. So like flight attendants tell us in every single safety message, we need to take care of ourselves before we can effectively take care of other people. When we let ourselves become completely emotionally exhausted, we no longer have the resources left to give to those that we love. Though it has been proven that giving empathy and taking care of others can replenish us, as in a study from Salovitz and Perry in 2010. When we become so depleted that our cups no longer refill through those everyday empathetic activities, we're in danger. But if we are to prevent draining these cups, we first need to recognize the warning signs. So how do we know that we're emotionally fatigued, that our emotional cup is empty? What are some of the signs? Do you guys have any ideas? Yes, irritability, negative self-talk, inability to have patience with others, finding reasons to be angry with others, and sadness. What do some of these things have in common? I'll tell you. They start in our thoughts. We see them in things we think before they become actions. It's plain and simple stinking thinking. I love that phrase. And I'm sure some of you have heard that before. But when the voice in your head starts to tell you that you aren't good enough because you don't fit some specific category, or you haven't done this thing that, you know, Betty White has done, or you haven't done it in this certain way. Maybe you've done it, but like she used purple and you used blue and nobody likes your blue. It could be anything, but the voice gets louder when our cups get low. We have trouble fighting it when we're not filled. The good news is that God has given us so many different ways in which we can continually fill our cups. As we have already been shown, physical activity and spiritual wellness are two ways that we can refresh ourselves. Like Lauren was saying, you move your body, it helps your brain. Another is to take those stinking thinking thoughts captive. Through Christ, we can dismantle those lies and replace them with the truth of God. In 2 Corinthians 10:5, Paul tells the people of Corinth that because we are believers and we believe that we died and are resurrected with Christ, we have the power to take every thought captive and make it obedient to Christ. Greathouse, Carver, and Metz, theologians with the Nazarene Publishing House around the 1960s, put it this way: the power of God is able to break down barriers in the minds and hearts of men by means of a truly gospel ministry. That knowledge that Christ took it for us and that he died for us and we are now resurrected with him. This is amazing news. We no longer have to live with the negativity. But how do we do that? Take every thought captive. That is my biggest challenge. It seems like such a daunting task. Well, like Amber told us, it starts by refreshing ourselves in God's word. When we know what God says about us, we can effectively combat the enemy with truth. Here are a few things that God says about you, each and every one of you. We have been chosen. In John 15:16, he says, "You did not choose me. I chose you. I appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit so that the Father will give you whatever you ask for using my name." In Deuteronomy 7:6, "The Lord your God has chosen you to be his own special treasure." Something that is truly valued. People look for it in the sea. People make maps to it. Treasure. God purposefully picked each one of us to be his daughters. He knew every single one of us before we were born, before the world even began. In our lowest points, think of those moments before you knew Christ. Think of some of the things that you were doing. I know what I was doing. He was running after us, drawing us close to him so that we could walk with him. He delights in us. I love words. Think about that word, delight. It's very pretty and light, and it's just full of happiness and joy. In Psalms 147:11, He tells us the Lord delights in those who fear him, not afraid, but follow him, who put their hope in his unfailing love. In Zephaniah 3:17, my personal favorite, the Lord God is living among you. He is a mighty Savior. He will take delight in you with gladness. With his love, he will calm all your fears. He will rejoice over you in joyful song. And it doesn't matter if you think you can sing or not, he'll still sing with you. God looks at us and he's happy to see us. Since we have been washed clean by the precious blood of Jesus, God sees us exactly how he created us. When we sing praises to him from the depths of our heart, he is singing right along with us because it brings him joy. By joining Christ, we are now like Peter after Jesus' resurrection. He looks at us with love. And this is not the last thing that he says about us, but it's the last thing I'm mentioning tonight. He thinks we are amazing. How precious are your thoughts about me, O God? They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of sand. And when I wake up, you are still with me. In Romans, but God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. Let's take a minute and let those things sink in. The God who created the universe thinks we're amazing. He delights in us. He purposefully chose us to walk with him. Amen. So along that same vein of replacing the harsh thoughts, those terrible things that we hear that the enemy tries to say about us, along those same veins, it's spending time with God, because he obviously wants to be with us. Meditating on God's word, on those same very thoughts, has been proven to build new neural pathways in your brain. There's a whole science about how God affects our brain. This will reduce symptoms of anxiety and worry. Again, you got to be consistent. And I know we are all busy. I am in grad school. I get it. We don't always have time for long periods of meditation. But we do have 5 minutes here and 5 minutes there where we can join God, remembering that vast love for us. Simply trying to memorize a verse, even if it's a paraphrase, memorizing one of your favorite verses will give you time thinking about how God feels about you. Verses such as the ones we just looked at remind us of the many good things our Father thinks about us. Receiving that love from our Heavenly Father will give you energy, calm your fears, and help you go about your day. Christ even gives us the perfect example of self-care when he takes time away from the crowd to pray, meditate, and spend time with the Father. In Mark 6:46, Jesus goes up to a mountainside alone to spend time in prayer with the Father. We also see that even Jesus needed to be replenished. In Matthew 14:13, it tells us as soon as Jesus heard the news, he left in a boat to a remote area to be alone. But the crowds heard where he was headed and followed on foot from many towns. He was going on a boat to a solitary place to be alone because he was dealing with the grief of losing his cousin John the Baptist. He had just heard that he had been killed, and he needed a minute to process with his dad. But, like so many of our lives today, the only time he got was when he was alone in that boat on his journey to the solitary place. And like Jesus, we can use those few minutes that we get alone in the car. I get a lot of time in the car, if you can't tell. To listen to the Bible app that Amber was talking about. I love YouVersion. Or it can read that scripture to you. Or you can even use that time in prayer, because you don't have to pray with your eyes closed. We can choose a verse of the day, week, or even month. I think I spent like 6 months memorizing Zephaniah 3:17. And we can contemplate it in our short journeys, in our long journeys, to wherever we have to go. I often find that if I choose a verse and focus on it line by line, God reveals more of himself to me each time I say it. I found Zephaniah 3:17 because I'm a musician and I love singing, and somebody told me that it mentioned God singing. So I read it, and that's the line that I thought of. And then I was reading it again, and it was like, with his love, he will calm all your fears. I'm always afraid of something. That's amazing. And then I saw that it was talking about how the Lord lives among you, and I was like, that points directly back to Jesus and the Holy Spirit living in me right now. And so the more I read it, the more I got out of that verse. Another way we can do that is through apps like YouVersion or Bible Gateway. You can find a lot of different translations. So like Amber was talking about, you don't have to be in, you know, the old medieval English. There are plenty of different translations that you can find that can help you break down the Bible. If we look at Matthew 10:29-30, in the ESV, the English Standard Version, it says, "Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? And not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. But even the hairs on your head are all numbered." Now, if we move that to the Passion Translation, it sounds a little bit different. "You can buy two sparrows for only a copper coin. Yet not even one sparrow falls from its nest without the knowledge of your Father. Aren't you worth much more to God than many sparrows? So don't worry, for your Father cares deeply about even the smallest detail of your life." And finally, let's look at the Good News Translation. "For only a penny, you can buy two sparrows. Yet not one sparrow falls to the ground without your Father's consent. As for you, even the hairs on your head have all been counted." Those verses say exactly the same thing, but each one shows God's heart just a little bit differently. They give us a depth of understanding beyond what we get by reading a single version. Something else to consider, and I don't know about you all, but for me, after a while, I find myself less receptive to the same words I've heard repeatedly. Just by looking at a familiar verse in a new language, I'm able to connect back to the heart of our Lord in a brand new way. These meditations on Scripture reveal God's word written on our hearts. Sometimes, though, we need a bit more time to meditate than just the few minutes in our cars or in between tasks. In fact, Jesus tells us in Matthew 6:6, "But when you pray, go away by yourself, shut the door behind you, and pray to your Father in private." If we are struggling to find time to do that, this may be a time when we call on the gift of community, just like we are today. God has given us a community to refresh our weary hearts. In Galatians 6:2, we are told to carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. In those moments where we need help finding a few minutes alone with God, our community can help us. Maybe it's through a program for the kids, like they offer it at church, and you can come and, you know, go out with community or go out into the parking lot and stay in your car. Maybe it's a women's retreat. I know some of the women's retreats we've had afternoons where it is free time and you can go into the mountains by yourself or something to that effect. Or even calling a sister in Christ to help with children or to take a task that is preventing you from spending time alone in prayer. We as women in Christ should be ready to serve our sisters as well as be able to lean on each other during times of need. Community also helps refill our mental and emotional cup by being partners in prayer. We should be ready to pray for each other in a judgment-free manner. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. That's James 5:16. And while community at first glance may seem like a word that always means a lot of people, it can sometimes mean simply two or three followers gathering together in the name of God. I know that I don't want to confess my sins to a room full of people, or to even somebody I don't know very well. But it's important to spend time in the community at large so that you can make those connections with each other and find women with whom you can become close and maybe share your spreadsheet with them. If I'm finding my mental cup dry as a desert, I may need to call my sister in Christ to come pray with me or listen as I share my troubles. You can ask Amber, you can ask Wendy, I've done it. As part of my community, that sister can point me back to Jesus. And by joining each other, we become powerful with the Spirit. Matthew 18:20 tells us that for when there are two or three gathered together as my followers, I'm there among them. So that's a pretty quick way to get God there with you in that moment. We as a community also share each other's joys and walk through each other through all of the different phases of life. When you are part of a community, you have people to lean on in times of sadness and people to celebrate with in times of joy. Totally called Amber when I was like, I made a spreadsheet for my niece's visit. I'm so excited. We are created in God's image as the three-in-one God. He wants us to be surrounded by those people who love and care for us. When we stay connected in the body of Christ, there's always a shoulder to cry on, an encouraging word, someone in your corner to cheer you on, but most of all, someone to remind you of God's love for us. Together, we can stay more easily alert and resist the temptation to stand firm in our faith, just as we are called to do. In 1 Peter 5:8, he tells us to stay alert and watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around roaring like a lion, looking for someone to devour. He also tries to sound a whole heck of a lot like God. And so when Carissa sounded like Amber, that couldn't have been closer to the truth. We see in Genesis that the enemy took God's word and changed it by the smallest little minutia so that she was fooled. And when we have our sisters to point us back, you know, that doesn't sound like God. Like, just the whole statement wasn't true, so it can't be true. It helps us to do that. And when we're helping our sisters create time for God, when we're lifting each other in prayer and walking side by side with each other through all of the seasons of life, we are defeating the enemy. So now, I want to do a little activity that kind of shows you what it looks like when we put our mental, emotional energy in trusting God. I've already asked Esme to help me, so if you will come on up. All right, so do you guys know what an I-beam is? I didn't. An I-beam, like the letter I. Here's an image, and we've got a second one. So it's a structure in a building. I want you to hold on to that image. Okay. All right. So I already asked you if I could put my hands on you. So I'm going to have you stand right here. I'm going to have you hold your arm out as straight as possible, okay? All right. Now, I am going to try and move your arm. You ready?
Okay.
I'm not very strong right now.
Hey, you're stronger than me. I got you to move. All right. So now I want you to take that image. Can you put that back up again? Woo! Thank you. I want you to take that image of that beam, okay? I want you to put your arm out again. I want you to imagine that that beam is actually in your arm, and it goes all the way to the wall. Here, we'll move you over so that you're like, actually, there you go. It goes all the way to that wall, and it's in it. And I want you to imagine that it's all the way in that wall, and it's in it. Like, you are connected to this beam. It is part of your body. All right, you got it?
Yeah.
Are you sure?
No.
Okay. All right, think about it really hard. I'd be like, my arm is a beam, my arm is a beam. Okay. All right, okay, here we go. All right, here we go. Yeah. Did I use less or more force that time? She didn't move at all. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry.
No, you didn't hurt me.
I'm sorry. Thank you.
I was arm wrestling yesterday. And my arm
but
sore.
I told you we were going to do a physical activity tonight. So the point of that, she just used her imagination. That's not something as real as our God. And that imagination made it harder for her to move. So when we build on our spiritual fullness, on our physical fullness, in our mental, emotional fullness, and it is founded in the God of the universe, in Christ, our Savior, how much stronger are we in every day of our lives? So my challenge for you is find some sisters in Christ. Maybe somebody new that you met here tonight. Maybe somebody that you already know. And become a team. Be like, hey, are you going to be my ride or die? If I am calling you and I think the enemy is attacking, will you pray with me? Will you call me out when I'm like, oh my gosh, this is going through my head? And be like, no, that's not what Jesus says about you. I don't have a time limit, but I think it's important that we develop that. Now, we're going to move forward. I am inviting my friend up onto the stage. She has been a part of our church for quite a while. I don't know the exact amount of time, and I'm not going to make it sound like anybody's old, because I don't like that. She has spoken at lots of women's retreats and many other events. I've heard her speak. She is a gifted speaker. She is also the queen of sparkle, always sparkling, Miss Jen Lowe.
Hello? No, that's okay. Okay, so, well, that's embarrassing to be told I'm the queen of sparkle. I don't know. No, that's good. So I'm going to be completely honest and very transparent with all of you here. So for those of you who have heard me speak or maybe been to a retreat or something like that, I'm actually a lot like Amber and Bonnie in the way of I have everything planned out. I've rewritten it 10 times. I've reorganized it. I'll have sheets for every single one of you. I'll act it out. I'll do anything I can to make sure that it can be helpful in the way of life application. today I had zero, nothing for any of you. I actually showed up with a blank piece of paper. And I was like, okay, God, this is where I'm at. This is about transparency, and I'm just going to show up and be who I am. So I have a question for all of you first. How many of you here showed up unbalanced, off kilter, maybe out of sorts, a little short-tempered, feeling like you're getting maybe a little fake sometimes, or you just feel not yourselves? Anybody, or am I the only person in the room? Okay, so there's a pretty good fair amount of us here. The one thing that I'm starting to learn is if we constantly put on this front that we have it all together, we sometimes keep everybody at arm's length because we can almost come across as unapproachable, because it makes other people feel like she's always got it together, everything's always great over there, and so you almost feel like you can't talk to those people sometimes because you don't want to be vulnerable or transparent. And so first let me start by saying I hope you all know that you can be as transparent as a sheet of glass with me always and forever. So if you ever see me and just want to lay it all out there, I'm going to put that out there for you. But the cups in front of you, the reason why I wanted to put that out there first is I want to give you a kind of a premise behind what these cups are about. And I'm a visual learner, and I'm somebody that likes things that are tangible so that I can see it and kind of get a grasp for it. So you have the three cups in front of you, and they all represent each woman that came up here tonight. The first one with the physical cup, and I got to tell you, Lauren, Lauren, I just about peed my pants when you came in the room. I was pretty excited, and I don't know if that's because I'm dating myself, and I was like, oh, I wish I had my jelly shoes and my little neon rubber bands, but I was so excited by you. But if you look at your cups, and if you look at the physical cup, I think that this was the one that I always had the biggest struggle filling that cup. And so in front of you with the three cups, you've got pieces of paper in each and every single one of them. And I had a conversation about these cups with Carolyn a few years back. And the reason we got onto the conversation of cups was because I had just been in this rut. And I couldn't figure out why and where I was at this place that I was at. I was like, I'm in my Bible every single day. And I'm going to Master Life. And I'm, you know, going to luncheons. And I'm going to Bible studies. And I'm doing all these things with all of my Christian friends. Why do I just still feel like a sloth? Like I'm just kind of sluggish. I don't get it. And then sometimes I'd be on a physical high because I'm like, I'm walking every day and I'm going with my friends and we're going to the lake and, you know, all these different things. And then on a mental emotional piece, you've got those cups there too. What we talked about is that, Jen, which one of your cups is not full? And so it's, let me give you a visual. Do you ever see you ever go to a restaurant and you're at a table and it's like this? It's like, it's off a little bit and it's constantly doing this and it's aggravating you because you can't put your glass on it because your glass is going like this or it's constantly doing this when you're trying to eat. That's gonna be the most aggravating thing. I can't tell you how many times in my life I have felt like a shaky leg table. And I'm like, I cannot put my finger on why I just cannot get on stable ground. And having these three cups in front of me and having these three cups to constantly fill and help me balance myself is what I was needing. And so when Carolyn and I were talking about this, it was like, Jen, get the three cups and give yourself a visual. So every single day, get up, grab these pieces of paper and find something from, you know, and it doesn't have to be exactly what the girls were talking about, but the physical cup. For me, it was hard. I'll be honest with you. I was into my third squat and I'm like, I'm feeling things in my backside I didn't know that I had. So I'm just gonna, and that's it. That's my physical piece. And so there's so many different things about the physical cup that you can really get that cup filled really quickly. You don't have to go for a 5K. You don't have to climb a 14K, a 14er. You don't have to do all these things. My mom's agoraphobic, and she doesn't leave the house, like literally physically doesn't leave the house. And so I bought her this little thing that she can sit and put under her desk and just to move her legs so that she doesn't become physically incapacitated. There are things that you can find in your house every day to fill your physical cup. On the second level, on the spiritual level, one of the things that I took out of when Amber was talking and what was important to me when I was listening to her talk, and I was like, where am I off this week? I think I'm probably off the most in the spiritual sense because I was saying to Carolyn earlier, I'm like, I'm doing my devotionals. I'm reading the Bible. I'm doing all these things, but it literally was a checklist. I was just checking them off. I read the Bible. I did the devotional. I did this worksheet, but I'm not applying it. So My circumstances are not what's causing me to feel unkiltered. It's the lack of stability that I have due to the fact that I'm not applying it to my life. So if you're not going to find physical things to do, it's not going to benefit you. If you're not going to dig deep, one of my phrases that I like to say the most is, am I sharpening your saw? So I thought it was neat when Lauren was talking about in the physical sense, you know, if you get two people and you have the guy who, I like how she talked about rest, because a lot of us don't think of taking care of our physical self as the rest piece. I am famous and infamous for being someone that will stay up until 4, get up at 6:30, and by 2 o'clock I'm just like, I have no idea what's wrong with me today. I don't know. It's probably because I Netflixed all night long watching Downton Abbey. And so now I'm exhausted. So taking that time to rest, but sharpening your saws, if you have two guys in the woods and you've got one guy cutting down a tree, and they're both using the same saw. They're both cutting down the same size tree. One guy stops, takes a break, and has some lunch. The other guy's like, nope, got to keep going. I got to get this done. You'd be amazed that it's the guy that stopped, took lunch, and was able to get that tree cut down a lot quicker, simply because of the fact that he sharpened his saw and he rested. And so a lot of us don't do things like that. Getting in the Word, don't just read it, apply it. Praying, don't just pray just to say, there's a verse and I wish I could think of it off the top of my head, but just don't have mindless chatter. Have a serious intent conversation with your God. Tell him where you're at. Sometimes your prayer is a cry out to him. And then the other thing that I actually found to be surprising that I haven't been doing in a long time, sharing the gospel with people. That is just an amazing thing on the spiritual piece of things. And for me, when I would want to fill my spiritual cup and the days that I was just struggling the most, finding something to put in that cup, I would sit and listen to praise and worship until I fell asleep. Just literally soak in his word through music. However, it's just going to resonate with you. So find a way to do that. And then the mental emotional piece, the last piece for this one, listening to Bonnie, I actually relate to you the most tonight. And this is the one where it's really been, escaping me. And the one that stuck out for me that I was like, I need to do this. And I used to do this all the time. And I caught myself the minute that I came up here. I'm like, oh, I'm embarrassed. Don't talk about me being like the girl of sparkle. But you know what? I am. I am a girl who sparkles. I mean, my hat, for crying out loud, that I wear a lot of times in town, people, it's full of glitter. And so the one thing that I stopped doing is self-affirmation. I've gotten into this place where it's easy to just be like, I feel like crap, I look like crap, I don't know. I came in here tonight and I saw all the speakers and the girls looking so lovely, and I'm like, well, I showered. So lucky for all of you. But there's nothing wrong with getting up and looking in the mirror and going, I am super smart, and I'm beautiful, and I'm funny sometimes. But above all of that, I'm chosen. I was chosen. I was chosen to be here today. I was chosen to have this conversation with you. You were chosen to be in these seats. You were chosen to absorb all of this. And I know that in all of this message, every single thing, there is something for everybody here. God had intended for all of you. So I want you to take all these cups home. I want you to take those papers. And if you struggle with finding something to fill that cup up, call somebody, like Bonnie was saying, reach out and be like, I'm struggling. I'm going through the week and it's Wednesday and I'm figuring out that I'm feeling kind of run down. Well, my physical cup is empty. Do you want to go for a walk with me? Find someone to join you with it. So I guess, of all of these things, I just want to encourage you ladies to, whatever it is that fills those cups, hone in on them. Don't let a day go by where you're not filling one of those cups with something, even if it's the most minimal thing, even if, like Lauren was saying, park a little bit further away, all these different things. So for me, I just want to remind you guys, you know, most of all, the balance, the life application, the consistency, but be honest with yourselves, with wherever you're at. Because if you're faking it, I think the thing that Christian women do the most, and I am infamous for it, is faking it. So don't fake it anymore. Just be real and genuine with where you are at. And I promise you, God is going to be placing people in your life and putting them in front of you, and use them and fill those cups. All I got for you.